I'm Alex Michaelson. This week on The Issue Is, Fox News correspondent Bill Melugin is back to discuss the issue of immigration and his recent ride-alongs with ICE agents. Plus, The Issue Is, California's $20 an hour minimum wage for fast food workers went into effect this week. How's it working? Our panel discussed that and more. Former Stockton Mayor Michael Tubbs and Chef Andrew Gruel. Plus, Steven Spielberg's warning about anti-Semitism as The Issue Is starts right now.
Broadcasting across California, you're watching The Issue Is.
The convicted felon that ICE just arrested is behind me being processed and booked right now.
Fox News correspondent Bill Melugin with ICE agents in Los Angeles recently. No network correspondent has covered immigration more closely than Bill from Fox News. He is back with us. Bill, great to see you.
Thanks for having me.
It's rare to see you in a suit these days, so looking nice.
Feels good.
Nice tailoring. Now, this issue of immigration could have a big impact on the election.
Yep.
A recent Gallup poll, which we'll put up on the screen now, shows that immigration is the number one issue in the country over concerns about the government, the economy, even inflation. And so people are focused on this. And you recently went along with ICE here in Los Angeles. What did you see?
So they had a targeted operation where they were going after drug traffickers. So they developed intel on three convicted felons, all convicted of felony drug trafficking, who are out in the community here in Los Angeles. LA is a sanctuary city, so the locals don't work with the feds. So ICE went out, arrested all three of them. Some had violent histories as well. Some had been deported multiple times. All had been released from custody without any notice to ICE. So ICE says, look, we're only going to go after the bad apples. We're not going after kids at school or grandmas in hospitals. We're going to go after convicted felons. So they picked up three of them and got them off the streets here.
And talk more about that when it comes to the sanctuary policy. How is that different than, say, in a different city?
So essentially, someone who is in the U.S. illegally commits a crime and gets convicted of a felony. Eventually, they got to get let out of jail or let out of prison. In a sanctuary jurisdiction, the locals will not notify ICE that, hey, this convicted child molester is going to be let out of jail. You might want to come get him. Or ICE will file what's called a detainer request, which is the Fed saying, hey, locals, can you please hold on to this guy for 48 hours so we can get agents there to take him into custody? The locals, if they're a sanctuary jurisdiction, they will not cooperate. They'll just release him to the streets.
Boston, also a sanctuary jurisdiction. You went out with ICE there. Here's some of that.
How are you guys not notified about a child rapist being released?
Unfortunately, in Massachusetts, that's how it is with most of these sanctuary jurisdictions.
So, similar problem there. What did you see on the streets of Boston?
It's actually a way worse problem in Boston. Their sanctuary policies are way more significant than here in LA. It was a jaw dropper. In one single morning when I was with ICE in Boston, they arrested four alleged child rapists and a violent MS-13 gang member, all in just a few hours. Mm. And every single one of them had been released from local custody. They did not honor ICE's detainer request. They were just put back out into the community, and ICE had to go find them. Child rapists.
Well, that is pretty astounding to watch all that happen. Meanwhile, we've talked to you so often when you were at the border. Just this week, our pal Matt Finn was out at the border and put up some video to his X account. We want to show that. It shows Texas with new wire fence being put in there. Talk to us about what's happening at the border, and are images like this making a difference?
So what's happening is these last couple of months, the numbers at the border have been significantly lower. Back at the end of 2023, it was record high numbers. We were seeing like 10 to 12,000 crossings a day. Right now, it's between 5 and 6,000 per day. And the question is, well, why? What you just saw in Texas, Texas has been fortifying their border, El Paso, Eagle Pass, Brownsville, putting up razor wire, barricades all over the place, the idea being keep people out. But another thing is also happening. The Biden administration has made some sort of an agreement with Mexico, and Mexico is now enforcing on their side of the border. They're taking migrants off trains. They're not letting them ride up on buses to the border. They got National Guard posted all over the place. They're stopping these migrants from getting to the border, and they're not just taking them into custody. They're then shipping them down to Tapachula, which is in southern Mexico. So these numbers are lower for a myriad of reasons, and the question is, is that going to hold going into the traditionally busy spring and summer?
I know we don't hear about this that much, but that seems to be a Biden policy that's working, at least right now.
It is. If you remember, towards the end of last year, Secretary of State Antony Blinken and DHS Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas went to Mexico and met with Mexico's leaders when we were in the middle of those record high numbers. And there was some sort of an agreement that was made. Now, the details of that agreement have never been made public, so we don't know what it is. But it's very clear ever since then, Mexico has been beefing up enforcement on their side of the border.
We have also seen year after year you out there in the heat of the summer, 115 degrees with all these people crossing. What do we see in terms of the forecast for this summer?
Well, that's what's going to have to play out. Like, if Mexico continues this enforcement, we might see lower numbers, this 5,000 or 6,000 a day heading into the summer. Now, traditionally, Mexico, when they've done these enforcement, they don't keep it up for months. So if the last 3 years have been any indication, the Mexican enforcement's probably going to drop off at some point. We're going to start seeing record high numbers at the border again, because look, it's an election year. There are migrants out there who feel that Joe Biden's a lot more friendly when it comes to immigration than Donald Trump is. And if they think he might get voted out of office this year, you get the idea. A lot of them are going to try to show up before he potentially gets voted out.
Well, it's interesting because you've been talking about this issue for years at a point when a lot of other people weren't talking about it. Now it seems like the whole country is talking about it, the number one issue. What do you make of that, and maybe why that's happening?
Well, I think for a couple years it was just, hey, look at these live shots down at the border, people spilling across the border. And it was just like, it's an over there sort of a thing. It was Texas. It was Arizona. It was out of the way. I think once Governor Abbott really started busing them around the country and these blue cities, sanctuary cities, started having masses of migrants showing up, and all of a sudden, you got to pay for them. You got to put them somewhere. And when taxpayer dollars started going towards these migrant hotels, and now cities are talking about having to cut police departments or education budgets, people sitting at home in these interior states start thinking, wait, what's going on here? That's just a Texas thing. Not anymore. It's not.
Yeah. You know, how do you, because this is some pretty serious, heavy stuff, how do you unwind in this situation?
Look, I think that it's a hugely important story that has to be told, because for a long time, we were essentially the only ones down there covering it, right? Now it's kind of more in the mainstream, and you see it in a lot of these exit polls in these primary states. Immigration has been at the top of the list. So does it suck doing live shots in 115 degrees with mosquitoes and gnats in your eyes dripping sweat every single hit? Yes, it does. But it's a big, important story. And look, I love coming back home and hitting the beach when I get a chance. That helps me unwind.
And we also learned the last time you were on The Issue is that you love listening to The Weeknd, which I would have never thought would be your jam, but apparently it is.
Yeah.
So we'll be back with more of The Issue is, but we go to break with Bill Melugin's favorite, The Weeknd.
The opportunity to reward that contribution, reward that sacrifice.
That was Governor Newsom in September when he signed legislation for the 540,000 fast food workers who work across California, increasing their minimum wage from $16 an hour to $20 an hour. It went into effect this week. Here to talk about that and more is our panel this week. Michael Tubbs is the former mayor of Stockton. He's a special advisor to California Governor Gavin Newsom for economic mobility. You can read his remarkable life story in his memoir, The Deeper the Roots, which has been endorsed by Oprah and Alice Walker, among others. Andrew Gruel is a chef, TV host, and restaurant owner. He is the co-owner of the Calico Seafood Chop House in Huntington Beach. And these photos of his food are making all of us hungry. Well done with that. Very nice. Welcome, guys. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having us.
Chef, since you're the chef, let's start with you. And we're talking about the restaurant industry. This fast food, $20 an hour minimum wage, no other state in the country has it. I know you pay your workers over minimum wage. You believe in that. Mm-hmm. But you don't believe in this as a government regulation.
Correct. And I know that there might be some inherent conflict in that statement, right? I've read the bill and gone into detail. So I'll say a couple things about it. I think that the bill's intention is actually really good. I think that we should be treating our workers a lot better. I think people should be paying them more. I've said this. I've railed against the corporations. I just don't necessarily agree with the means by which they get there. I think that a lot of the language in this bill is incredibly redundant. My philosophy behind this bill is that it's actually going to hurt the worker because they're going to get laid off. A lot of things are going to get automated. The big corporations saw this coming, and they're already starting to do that. We've seen it with Pizza Hut. We've heard all the news over the past couple days. And then those workers are going to be out of job, which is going to cost the state more money in unemployment benefits. So in closing, what I would say is that my perspective on this is that while I agree with the idea, I think that we need to change the incentive structure, right? So if we change it such that we cut payroll taxes for the businesses that are paying their employees really well and there's the right incentive structure there, then we don't need these new layers of bureaucracy and government officials that are ultimately going to be dropping a hammer on these businesses. And we can support those businesses that treat and pay their workers well. And if they don't, well, guess what? They're going to be paying the current level of payroll tax, if not higher, if they don't treat them well.
Mayor Tubbs, your thoughts?
No, I first of all, I appreciate the thinking around different incentive structure. And I think part of what precipitated this bill was the fact that of the unsheltered workers, the biggest sector they work in are fast food workers. These are 500,000 people who are making less than $40,000 a year in an incredibly expensive state. At the same time, the corporations are making billions of dollars. So I don't think any law is perfect, but I do think sort of raising the floor, as you've done with your businesses, is good, right? And I think we also have to be thoughtful about it's not a magic bullet. It's not going to solve everything. We should look at sort of ways to reward good employers. We should look at ways to make it easier for small businesses to operate. But I think for the state of California, it's a good thing. And as we've seen since we've raised the minimum wage the last several years, that I think over 100,000 fast food jobs have been created since the minimum wage rose in 2015, 16, 17, 18, and now.
But when you see the prices are already going up in a lot of fast food, doesn't that really hurt, especially low-income people who eat fast food disproportionately?
But I think what's frustrating about the conversation around this bill in particular is that we're blaming this particular bill for a lot of other outside market forces. We know that, I think I saw something this morning, that In-N-Out raised the price of a double-double 30 cents, despite the fact they were already paying their workers above the current minimum wage, et cetera. So I think prices are raising, but that's more of a symptom of corporate greed, of price gouging, and less of a response to this particular legislation. And in fact, people having more money makes them better able to pay for these increased prices. But I'm not sure it's safe to say that these prices are increased because the minimum wage was increased.
Your thoughts on that?
Well, yeah, and I actually agree with that to some degree. I do think that the economy is already increasing prices by virtue of national inflation and what's happening with our currency. I think specifically in the markets in which this is really going to disproportionately hurt small businesses and medium-sized businesses, whether it's an individual franchisee owner or a small business, because I know that this applies only to the fast food restaurants with 60 plus more locations, et cetera. This is now going to hurt the smaller businesses because if I lose all my employees and they go to work for somebody else and I can't afford to automate or I can't afford to pay $20 an hour, which, you know, not because of corporate greed, when it's just like a mom and pop run shop, they're going to have to increase their wages in order to compete, which means they're going to increase their prices. And I'll also throw in there, too, if we put the $20 minimum, you know, wage piece of this bill aside, I think we could actually get into a lot more of the meat that we can kind of dissect and take apart, because, frankly, I think we're beyond $20 already. And 20 isn't even living wage in most places. San Francisco, it's $35 an hour. But then on the flip side, in Bakersfield, California, living wage is $16.66 an hour, right? So how do you apply this bill on a regional basis when it's just kind of a blanket number across a state that's as big as, you know, most countries?
Right. It's just such so huge. And all of these things that we're dealing with in California right now go down to our biggest issue, which is affordability. It is so hard to live here because it's just out of reach, especially housing for a lot of people. This is something you work on as much as anybody. The last time you were with us, you talked about this idea of piloting universal basic income across the state. Where are we at on that? Any sort of top line update on that?
Yeah, I think the top line update is that we have over 150 mayors across the country who are doing this work. And the state with the highest numbers in California, about 30, 35 mayors, 10 counties. LA County has the largest program in the country. And what we're seeing is that, much like the debate we're having about minimum wage, is that when people are given money, they are able to spend in the local economy. They're able to take care of their family. They're able to pay for rent. And they're able to work, in fact, consistently, not just in California, but across the country. Everywhere this has been piloted, we see the same thing. Employment goes up. Part-time to full-time work goes up. People are healthier and able to do the things we want them to do, like take care of their kids, participate in community, and work.
Do you think it's an interesting idea?
Actually, I do. I'm very familiar with Michael's work in regards to UBI and his end poverty initiatives, and I actually agree fundamentally with all of it. Where I would disagree is the way in which we get there. I think that when we're taking taxpayer dollars to give them to people, I think that the government's going to siphon off a portion of that. I want to see $1 of $1 go to the people as an investment in order to help them, give them kind of this stepping stone. I agree with that 100%. I think there's ways in which you can do it where you bring in private corporations, nonprofits, and you actually give, once again, change the incentive structure, give them tax incentives or cuts so that all of that money goes directly to the organization and they disseminate $1 on $1. I just don't trust the government to not keep some for themselves.
Your thoughts on that?
Wait, that's a win. Like, I think the fact that we can agree that, yes, we should trust people with money, invest in people, that's a huge shift from where we were just 5 years ago. And like I said, I'm also, innovation applies in all things. So I'm definitely open to ways to do so in which that the more money goes directly to folks. Like, I don't think bureaucracy, just for bureaucracy's sake, is a good thing. So we definitely have agreement there.
Look at this. We're making deals happen here on The Issue Is. Another story that got a lot of national attention this week is this bill put forward by Matt Haney, the assembly member from San Francisco, which would essentially say that your boss can't contact you after hours. With the exception being an emergency or if there was a situation with a scheduling change, and they could potentially be fined $100 encouraging people to disconnect from work. Is this a good idea or just too much bureaucracy?
Well, you know, I talk about the bureaucracy again, and I think it's just layers and layers and layers of bureaucracy that continue to give either unelected officials or appointed officials more power over the individual. So I don't fundamentally agree with it. However, I will flip this and say this. I'm totally fine with the basis of this bill, but I think it needs to work both ways. I think also employees can't communicate with me after hours and contact me, because I'll tell you right now, it's lopsided. 200 text messages from the team members. I'm not bothering them after hours, I assure you that.
Okay. Is this a good idea, or is this a little unnecessary?
Well, first, let me, full disclosure, Assemblymember Haney is one of my dearest friends, so okay. A big supporter. And I think his study of other countries and how they seem to have more work-life balance is what kind of motivated this bill. But I think, to your point, the good employers already do this. And from my understanding of the bill, it just says you have to have a policy. Like, you and your employers have to have something written that talks about sort of what's the protocol for communicating after hours. And with that explanation, this makes a lot of sense. I'm surprised everyone doesn't already do that.
So Governor Newsom has not given the official state of the state yet. It's been delayed two different times. We still aren't clear exactly when it's coming. But as somebody who looks at the state very closely, both of you, I was wondering, if you had to describe the state of the state in a sentence, what is the state of the state of California right now?
Progressing, but still with challenges.
Your thoughts?
I would say too top-heavy, way too expensive, and that's by virtue of the tax system.
Okay. So we found some areas of agreement, some areas of disagreement, but we do want to end with something called personal issues. This is where we do the cultural favorites. Both of you, I think, have done this at different points, but I want to see if we can find areas where you may or may not agree. So we're going to do our personal issues game, and we'll ask each of you the same question. First thing that comes to mind, what is your favorite TV show right now?
So Good.
Oh, my gosh. Probably Bluey.
Bluey.
I almost said Bear, because you're here, but I haven't watched it.
Favorite musical artist?
My gosh, I would say either musical artist, all-out musician, Herbie Hancock or Keith Jarrett.
Nice. I'm not going to say Keith Sweat. J. Cole.
J. Cole, we know that. Favorite sports team?
Lakers.
Yankees.
And what is the best part about being a dad?
Everything. Like, it's just... What's not the best part? Everything. I say everything.
Yeah, and you've got three kids, right? Three kids right now, and you've got...
Four kids,
which is crazy. I've got no kids. I'm way behind you guys. What's the best part about being a dad?
Well, I can be a kid again, and they laugh at my jokes. I mean, it genuinely gives me license to be a complete child.
That's true. And does your wife give you that license too?
No, she actually revoked my license, even with the DMV. No. Yeah.
Well, great to have both of you here. Thanks for the work that you do in our community. We appreciate it. We got to check out your restaurant. We got to do this over food next time.
Yeah, I mean, that's so much easier that way,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah,
exactly. But we end with music always on this show, and I know how much you love J. Cole.
Appreciate it.
We go to break with some J. Cole. More of The Issue Is after this.
One time for my L.A. sisters. One time for my L.A. Lame, can't tell the difference. One time for an...
This week, Issue Is editor Debbie Kim and myself honored to receive the Golden Mike Award for our profile last March of Selena Binias, the youngest girl on the real-life Schindler's List. At the time, Binias told us that the 1994 movie Schindler's List made her feel seen and wanted to share her story for the first time. Just recently, Binias and Schindler's List director Steven Spielberg were honored at USC for their work via the Shoah Foundation, telling the story of the Holocaust.
Selena Binias.
Since we last talked, the October 7th attack happened, and we have seen this rise in anti-Semitism around the world.
This time it's kind of rising again in a very ugly way, the way it was in the 1930s, you know.
It reminds you of that.
Oh, absolutely. Things beginning to sound so much like what Hitler used to say.
Stopping the rise of anti-Semitism and hate of any kind is critical to the health of our democratic republic and the future of democracy all over the civilized world.
You can see that full story at youtube.com/Elex Michaelson. By the way, Spielberg has said that his work with Shoah is more important to his legacy than any of the films that he's made. We'll be right back. Next week on The Issue Is, Gloria Allred and Larry Elder are back in studio for another epic debate. And in 2 weeks, Meta World Peace will be back to talk basketball, mental health reform, and his recent support for Robert F. Kennedy Jr. We end this week with the song The Ties That Bind from Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band, because we're talking about a historic tie in California's 16th Congressional District. Remember, the top two candidates are supposed to advance after the March primary. Former San Jose Mayor Sam Liccardo finished first, but Assemblyman Evan Lowe and Supervisor Joe Simidian tied for second with exactly 30,249 votes each. You may have better odds of winning the Powerball than coming out with a literal tie. So what happens next? Both Lowe and Simidian advance, and the top two runoff will be a top three runoff in that district alone. And now all their friends really do know that every vote counts.
If you can't sit on the sidelines, this is it.
A win is a win is a win. We're in.
We'll see you next week for more of The Issue Is.